A few weeks ago, I found myself sitting opposite the director of the bioastronautics program at MIT. Dr. Young has become very well known because he was one of the first people to ask the question, so why is it that astronauts are puking in space all the time? And has since become very well renowned and respected for his work on the vestibular system and on the challenges that astronauts face in space related to balance and spatial orientation. And he asked me, so how does the bioastronautics work that we do here relate to dance? I reflected on my 4 years, nearly, with the Duke Dance Department and remembered a master class with a woman named Helen Pickett, who taught us methods in the William Forsythe technique in modern dance, including a set of exercises called cross hemispherics, in which we were challenged to cross our bodies as many times as we could while still remembering the pattern enough to reverse it or do it on the other side or teach it to somebody else. And these exercises are meant to adapt a dancer to learning choreography quickly by mirroring it, to better appreciate the connection between different body parts, and to understanding the relationship between different parts of your body and the dancing space. So I said, well, we already give astronauts exercises for their bones and muscles in space. Why not give them exercises for their vestibular systems so that they, like dancers, can adapt to a new environment by learning to understand the space and challenging their brains with these teasers, these brain-body teasers. You might be wondering what kind of a nut I must be to get myself in this situation. Well, my name is Katrina Wisdom. I'm a senior in mechanical engineering here at Duke, and I'm also a lifelong ballet dancer. And last year, I presented to the Duke community some of my ideas, and I challenged engineers to apply what they knew to the art of ballet, and I challenged dancers to connect bits of their physical intuition that they had developed to technical terms in math and science. And I challenged everyone to make connections in unlikely places to see what wisdom could be gained. So I'd like to share with you a couple of the connections that I like to play with when I'm taking a ballet class. So it may look effortless when you see a dancer on stage in a balance, but I assure you it's anything but. And dancers have developed bad habits in learning how to do it, including clenching their fists or their neck or staring at a spot on the wall. And these don't really help. But what does help for me is to remember that, like every other object in the universe, I'm an object that has a center of mass. And physics tells me that if my center of mass is between my supports, no matter what position I'm in, as long as there's alignment there, I should be able to balance. And so this has helped me tremendously. By being conscious of my body alignment, I can balance. As you can see here, the partnering couple even has their joint center of mass directly above their support. Dancers will do anything also to improve their extensions, how high and straight they can get their legs. So how can we actually improve our extension in a way that won't allow us to compromise technique or become injured? Well, let's think of torque, the effect of a force acting at a distance. The same reason why we use a wrench to tighten or loosen a screw, in order to magnify the effect of the force of our hands. Well, we want to minimize the torque on our hip, if this is our leg out this way, and the position we most want to avoid is the one in which our leg is as far away as possible from our hip, which is this position here at 90 degrees. So what if we could avoid that situation entirely and still get our leg up high? We could do that by lifting our knee up and extending it. And that is also technically correct in dance, to go through passe before lifting your leg. So here we've avoided the situation with the most amount of torque on our hip, and we've done it technically correctly. And so here you can see, just like a lever, just like a seesaw, we want to reduce that torque on our hip. Finally, Betsy over here has incredible turns, and consecutive turning in dance is always a crowd pleaser. So how can you achieve these consistent, reliable turns? Well, let's look at a concept called resonance. Resonance is the reaction of a system that is driven at the frequency it would naturally oscillate. So imagine your friend on a swing set. You want to make your friend go swing very high. Do you just push randomly? No. Do you push once and then just walk away? No. You try and match the cadence of their swing in order to transfer your energy maximally. And if we think of our bodies in this kind of consecutive oscillating turning motion to be like an oscillating system, we are driving it with our head spotting, our arms going in and out, our bottom leg pushing up and down, and our top leg whipping around. So if we can coordinate all of these oscillations together to drive the system, we'll have efficient, reliable turns. Lastly, a bit of a conceptual idea here. Resolution is the number of pixels in a given image. So you see a high resolution image and a low resolution image. If pixels were conscious choices in dance, what would high resolution dancing be? Well, low resolution would be, someone just told me to do a plié, so I'm going to bend my legs. What if instead we could break that down into 1,000 smaller choices and we were more conscious of our entire bodies and how they were moving in the space? So instead, I'm going to think my toes are pushing through the ground and I'm going to bend my knees outward through my hips, my arm's going to come up, this pinky's going to be connected to this shoulder and my neck's going to be up and my eyes are going to be going this way. And the movement is so much fuller and more deliberate that way. And likewise, what if we could live in a way that's high resolution? It would mean nothing is on autopilot, and all of our choices were deliberate and conscious, and we were constantly asking ourselves, do they relate to my intentions and my goals right now? So who cares? Well, the National Academy of Engineering has put forth 14 grand challenges to engineers of this generation, and one of them is to advance personalized learning, to tap into individual styles of learning and speed and interest to engage students in science, math, and engineering. And this is the one I felt most poised to address because I've done it for myself. And so I can envision a future in which science homework gives students to more easily the chance to connect their personal interests, the languages they speak, to the languages of math, science, and engineering, so that they can stay engaged and find their way through this often rigorous curriculum as I have. And so I leave you with this thought, which is to make your own connections, to stay engaged, and to find your way. Thank you.